From Brazil's birth as an independent nation in 1823, it was enshrined in its constitution that a new capital be built. Rejecting its Portuguese colonial past, the capital was to be moved to Brazil's interior in an effort to disperse the largely coastal population. The first republic constitution, drafted in 1891, stipulated that this new capital be located far from the original capital of Rio de Janeiro. A zone of 14,000 square kilometers on the Planalto Central of the Republic will be reserved to the Union and will be surveyed at the earliest opportunity so that within it can be established as a future federal capital. In 1960, under President Juscelino Kubitschek, this plan was realized. President Kubitschek was narrowly elected in 1956 on his I Will Build Brasilia platform. Seeing this as an opportunity to go down in history as the father of a modern and geopolitically integrated Brazil, he promised to the people that the new city would be completed by the time he left office. The new capital city, named Brasilia, was a part of his 50 years of prosperity and five plan. And so the five-year clock started ticking to build the capital of hope.
On this plateau, in this wilderness, shortly to be transformed into the guiding intellect of high national decision, I gaze anew past the tomorrows of my country and look upon this dawn with faith unshaken and unboundless confidence in her great destiny.
President Kubitschek invited his friend, Brazilian architect Oscar Niemeyer, to oversee the project. Niemeyer was known for his free-form modernism, exercising an unbridled freedom of expression against the limitations imposed by history. Niemeyer was inspired by Le Corbusier's modernist architecture and rational approach to design. The two had worked on several projects together previously, including the reurbanization of Rio de Janeiro and the United Nations headquarters in New York City. Niemeyer was strongly influenced by these experiences, evident in Brasilia's modern simplicity of design and form. As constitutionally dictated, President Kubitschek held a public contest for the urban design of the new capital. With the help of architect Oscar Niemeyer and a group of jurors, Lúcio Costa's plan for Brasilia was chosen. Costa's urban design was selected because it was the only option that did not require slow, organic growth. Costa's winning design resembled a bird in flight, or an airplane, surrounded by a green belt in the hinterland. It featured a monumental axis of government buildings flanked by two wings of non-governmental urban land uses. The plan fulfilled the basic modernist principles established by Le Corbusier. The residences were constructed near green spaces on 2.5-acre superblocks, or as the laborers called it, superquadres. This plan featured very little mixed land use. Residences were located in tall buildings in the center of the superquadre, with higher density housing to the north. Costa appropriated a substantial amount of land to public use, including schools and parks surrounding the residential areas. Commercial areas also encircled the residential areas. These land uses were separated from industry, which resided in the periphery. As with many modernist designs, the planners intended Brasilia to be experienced in the automobile. This movement was facilitated by massive highways, which were separated from pedestrian circulation. While Niemeyer's buildings were modern and monumental, they were constructed from basic materials: brick, plaster, and concrete. This new modern city was intended to house, as Niemeyer put it, mis experiências a Brasilia, or free, fortunate men without racial or social discrimination. The landscape selected for the new capital of Brazil was no mistake. Its remote location and flat terrain enabled Costa and Niemeyer to create a completely new, modern city with no references to Brazil's colonial past. The majority of Brazilians had lived along the Atlantic coast since colonial times, and the new inland capital provided the opportunity to reverse Brazil's coastal emphasis. Thus, with the location selected and the plan in place, construction of Brasilia began in 1957. The candangos, or laborers who built Brasilia, came from all over the country, especially from the poorer areas of northeast Brazil. The candangos stayed in the Cidade Livre, or the Free City. This temporary shanty town was reported to be a lawless place of overworked laborers, isolated from their families, and abundant in the traditional Brazilian drink, caipirinha. According to Niemeyer, during its construction,
the rhythm of Brasilia was a 36-hour day, 12 during the day, 12 at night, and 12 for enthusiasm.
During the 41-month-long construction of Brasilia, Niemeyer lived on site with the construction workers. His accounts of his time ring with optimism, viewing the workers as his comrades in building a new city of equality. In truly modernist form, Brasilia was designed to support a specific population size and demographic. Costa planned for a city of 500,000, rigidly placing the residential units in the two wings. Planners anticipated that the majority of this population would be diplomats and bureaucrats working in the civic urban core. Throughout its construction, Niemeyer became aware of the irony of Brasilia.
Those comrades have been a long time in the capital they have constructed, and the houses they have built, the schools, nurseries, clubs, and palaces, all of which they created, in truth have no relation to them.
Although the city was not completely finished, Brasilia's inauguration took place on April 21, 1969. The day's inaugural celebration included an induction ceremony led by President Kubitschek, a luncheon, a parade, which the president and his wife attended, and numerous parties held throughout the day and night. The movement of the federal capital from Rio de Janeiro to Brasilia was also seen as a change in the overall national identity. Brasilia was supposed to represent the shift from Brazil as an old Portuguese colony to Brazil as a modern state. Like Costa's plan for Brasilia, Niemeyer's designs involved the themes of modern speed and an old and new Brazil. Through his designs used for Brasilia, Niemeyer created an architectural style that was unique in its characteristics, making this style of architecture exclusive only to Brasilia. Following Brasilia's inauguration, many of the roughly 30,000 condegos who built the city at a breakneck pace stayed. Without government jobs, however, the condegos were shunted out to the periphery, coalescing in satellite communities that range from well-built suburbs to unregulated shanty towns. The homes that Kubitschek proclaimed as housing for people of few resources were instead occupied by elite families, many of whom were offered substantial financial incentives to move. The pattern continued more and more as bureaucrats and influential Brazilians moved inland, supplanting the claims of laborers and leaving them to develop permanent settlements from temporary worker camps. Sadly, over the decades, many of these areas have remained impoverished, with Brazil's second largest favela, Condomínio Sol Nascente, forming just outside Brasilia's boundaries. Within the city, Brasilia's modernist embrace of technology as a tool to alleviate society's woes led to an unabashed embrace of the automobile. Seen as the future of transportation, Costa's plan ensured the car's central role in the city's design. The enormous spaces between districts and the majority of parkland in every part of the city made pedestrian travel untenable. Architect Jan Gale said of the city,
"Brasilia was the ultimate modernistic city, built on all the modernist manifests. It looks fantastic from the airplane, but if you are down at eye level, on your feet, and going from one place to another, Brasilia is a disaster. Every distance is too wide. Things are not connected. You have to trample for endless miles along completely straight paths. Nobody ever started to think about what it would be like to be out in Brasilia in between all these monuments."
It is among these monuments and structures for which Brasilia is so well known and praised that the city is further criticized. Technology journalist Julian DeBell described Brasilia as
intended, after all, to give the impression of having been built neither by nor for mere earthlings. A race of hyper-intelligent Volkswagens, perhaps, or aliens who speak a language made up entirely of Euclidean axioms, might be expected to feel at home in this sidewalk poor zone of perfectly circulating asphalt arteries and relentlessly clean lines of design, but not any species as puny and unkempt as Homo sapiens.
Despite its theoretical foundation in the idealism of perfect urban form, Brasilia has, in practice, developed a reputation for its monotonous landscape, inhuman size, and monolithic structures. The perfection of architecture and urban planning that Niemeyer and Costa thought would socially liberate Brazilians instead became a harsh lesson in the failures of design to resolve their country's inequalities.
Architecture was my way of expressing my ideals, to be simple, to create a world equal to everyone, and to look at people with optimism, that everyone has a gift. I don't want anything but general happiness. Why is that bad?
From design to implementation, Brasilia's story reflected the ambitions of a young nation and the ideals of its preeminent architect, visionary president, and self-assured planner. Although arguably a failure on many levels, Brasilia represents the singular embodiment of an idea like no other in history. A city with no past, no rational present. When Niemeyer was asked about the city soon before his death, he quipped,
"Brasilia is nothing anymore. It is not an example, simply a provincial capital."
Meu Brasil brasileiro, meu mulato risonheiro, vou cantar-te nos meus braços.